Please stand as you are able for our opening hymn.
Reading from Isaiah. Thus says the Lord, maintain justice and do what is right, for soon my salvation will come and my deliverance be revealed. And the foreigners who join themselves to the Lord, to minister to him, to love the name of the Lord, and to be his servants, all who keep the Sabbath and do not profane it, and hold fast my covenant, these I will bring to my holy mountain, and make them joyful in my house of prayer. Their burnt offerings and their sacrifices will be accepted on my altar, for my house shall be called a house of prayer for all peoples. Thus says the Lord God, who gathers the outcasts of Israel, I will gather others to them besides those already gathered. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Let us read Psalm 67 by head first, as printed in the bulletin. May God be merciful to us and bless us.
Show us the light of his countenance and bless us.
Let your ways be known upon earth.
Your saving health from all nations.
Let the peoples praise you, O God.
Let all the peoples
and sing for joy.
For you are the people set at liberty, and are God of all nations upon earth.
Let the peoples praise you, O God.
Let all the peoples praise you.
The earth has brought forth her increase.
May God, our own God, give us his blessing.
May God give us his blessing.
And may all the ends of the earth stand in awe of him.
A reading from Romans. I ask then, has God rejected his people? By no means. I myself am an Israelite, a descendant of Abraham, a member of the tribe of Benjamin. God has not rejected his people for whom he foreknew. For the gifts and the calling of God are irrevocable. Just as you were once disobedient to God, but have now received mercy because of their disobedience. So they have now been disobedient in order that, by the mercy shown to you, they too may now receive mercy. For God has imprisoned all in disobedience so that he may be merciful to all. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Holy Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to Matthew.
Glory to you, Lord Christ.
Jesus called the crowd to him and said to them, "Listen and understand. It is not what goes into the mouth that defiles a person, but it is what comes out of the mouth that defiles." Then the disciples approached and said to him, "Do you know that the Pharisees took offense when they heard what you said?" He answered, "Every plant that my heavenly Father has not planted will be uprooted. Let them alone. They are blind guides of the blind. And if one blind person guides another, then both will fall into a pit." But Peter said to him, "Explain this parable to us." Then he said, "Are you also still without understanding? Do you not see that whatever goes into the mouth enters the stomach and goes out into the sewer? But what comes out of the mouth proceeds from the heart, and this is what defiles. For out of the heart come evil intentions, murder, adultery, fornication, theft, false witness, slander. These are what defile a person, but to eat with unwashed hands does not defile." Jesus left that place and went away to the district of Tyre and Sidon. Just then, a Canaanite woman from that region came out and started shouting, "Have mercy on me, Lord, Son of David. My daughter is tormented by a demon." But he did not answer her at all. And his disciples came and urged him, saying, "Send her away, for she keeps shouting after us." He answered, "I was sent only to the lost sheep of the house of Israel." But she came and knelt before him, saying, "Lord, help me." He answered, "It's not fair to take the children's food and throw it to the dogs." She said, "Yes, Lord, yet even the dogs eat the crumbs that fall from their master's table." Then Jesus answered her, "Woman, great is your faith. Let it be done for you as you wish." And her daughter was healed instantly. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
Please be seated. So this Friday we had a baptism here in our parish, a new child of God inducted into the kingdom of heaven. That's why we have white on the altar today, because we used it for baptism, which we always do for baptism. But another reason that we have white on the altar is yesterday was the feast of Saint Mary the Virgin. So we honor that feast as well. It's a good reason for having white on the altar. The third reason is we didn't want to have to change it to green. Because we have a baptism next week too. So, and then one the following week. So good things are going on in our parish. White is only one of them. So today we talk about this story from the gospel lesson. And I really am not sure if I was Jesus' PR person, I would want this story to be told about Jesus ignoring the Canaanite woman, ignoring the illness of the woman's daughter. So why do we have this here? I think we have this here, and it's the only time it appears in any of the four Gospels. I think we have this here to let us know and to reaffirm for us that Jesus is still human. Jesus was human. Jesus was the divine and the human combined. So Jesus ignores her, and it's really bad enough that he does, but then the disciples want to dismiss her. They want to send her away. They say, don't bother us, leave us alone. We want to keep Jesus to ourselves. That's what we like about having this Jesus around her. But I wonder if Mary was there. Mary was, in fact, with Jesus during many of his travels. And on this one, he goes into Gentile territory, Tyre and Sidon, and places that were known as Gentile territory, not inhabited very much by the Jewish people to whom Jesus believes he was called. He said, I was called to teach the lost house of Israel. Don't bother me with the other people. And yet, this unrelenting woman continues on to push for that which she most needs, which is the healing of her tormented daughter, reminding us that even Jesus tells us that the dogs eat crumbs from the table, comparing her, if you can imagine Jesus doing this, comparing her to a dog. And it's not until the fourth attempt that Jesus finally says, woman, great is your faith. Let it be done for you as you wish. So I'm wondering how quickly this story about Jesus got around. And I'm wondering, from those hearers who heard this story, what did they think? What would they have thought about Jesus? Because this Jesus who is proclaiming the message of love your neighbor and also love your enemies, I wonder if this is consistent with that message that we've heard from Jesus in the past. So what I think this lesson may be about is boundary crossing. Where do we cross boundaries in our society today? This encounter is really right on the border in a lot of ways. It's on the border between male and female. It's on the border between Jew and Gentile. It's on the border between friend and enemy, and between holy and demon-possessed. So the gospel writer here, Matthew, refers to the woman as a Canaanite, the traditional enemies of the Jews. But here it is the Canaanite woman that crosses the border to meet Jesus. And finally, he accepts her. Finally, Jesus looks at this protagonist, and we are told the story, and we learn a lesson from this, because she initiates the entire exchange with him. So she takes this huge risk, doesn't she? She crosses this border. She crosses this boundary into Jesus' heart. And he ultimately is not deterred by her. And she is not deterred by him, even though the disciples request for her to be sent away. And she stakes her claim on her faith in the boundaryless love of God, that love and acceptance by Jesus and Jesus' healing of her. So she is vulnerable, she is desperate, she is likely hungry, but she's also bold. And that not only secures healing for her daughter, but she challenges the scope of Jesus' ministry. Before this, he believes that his ministry is solely to a certain type of people, but Jesus learns otherwise. So for us, who will challenge us? Who will increase the boundaries of our ministry, who will increase the scope of our ministry. How we want to think about Jesus as perfect, as compassionate, as a good listener, as welcoming, and as unprejudiced. That's an image of Jesus that we are often impressed with. But I'm not very interested in these interpretations that sanitize Jesus' encounter with the Canaanite woman. Many of the scholars have said, oh, this tells us that Jesus was only showing the disciples what the disciples needed to learn. It was a lesson for the disciples. I believe it's more than a lesson for the disciples. I believe it was a lesson for Jesus, and I believe it's a lesson for us as well. And that lesson is that God's mercy and love and generosity are for all people, not just for those whom we think are the ones that deserve it. So this story shines a light on Jesus' humanity, a light that we see often shine on Jesus, but now there is a different view. This is a view that was a different view about those whom Jesus' culture did not accept, and Jesus was changed by this incident. So we too can become blind to the humanity around us and the needs of the people who are not like us, people who don't look or think or talk like us. Just like Jesus, we can get it wrong. We can make negative generalizations about whole groups of people based on simply one encounter. But thankfully, we can also get our minds right, just like Jesus did. So I wonder if the woman's daughter isn't the only person healed by this encounter. Maybe Jesus ends up being healed, and maybe we can end up being healed as well. So Jesus' encounter with the Canaanite woman changes him, not just in that single moment, but it changes his entire view of what his ministry was about. It changes the entire shape of what Jesus' ministry was about. And until he had encountered this woman, even Jesus had not realized how expansive God's kingdom is and how inclusive God's grace is for all of us. He did not realize that racism was in the groundwater of his culture, and the experience of having his mind changed made all the difference and was a turning point in his ministry. So he was very well practiced in crossing boundaries, but this was one he had difficulty crossing. How often have we had difficulties in crossing those boundaries that are put there artificially or even put there intentionally? So in this world, I'm encouraged that even Jesus can get his mind changed about something that really matters, and particularly about someone that really mattered in that moment. This persistent woman shakes up how Jesus understands his call. She helps him see what he needed to see in that moment. So the question for us becomes, can we do that too? What does it take for us to see ourselves as being changed? What does it take for us to see our call as a disciple of Jesus differently from the way that we were always accustomed to see it? So to me, kinship is demonstrated in this encounter between Jesus and the Canaanite woman. And kinship also happens to us when we are able to remember that we all belong to each other. These days, there's a lot of high moral distance that separates us from them or the other in our time. So imagine, if you will, with me, with God, this giant circle of compassion, the kind of circle that will keep us inching ourselves closer to the margins of that circle, so that even the margins themselves become ill-defined and hopefully and perhaps totally disappear. So on the edges, we can join with those who are easily despised and readily left out. We can stand with the demonized so that the demonizing will stop. We can situate ourselves next to those who are seen as disposable so that the day will come when we eventually stop throwing people away. It would seem that quite possibly the ultimate measure of health in any society is this: are you kin to one another? This woman stood next to Jesus so that the demonizing of her daughter, and the demonizing that her daughter had endured would stop in that very moment, and all who were around got to see it and got to witness it. And I suspect that after this gospel reading is over, Jesus sought forgiveness, just like we seek forgiveness when we do the same thing. So as followers of Jesus in this time and this place, isn't this our call? Isn't it our call to do more than just know that there are no dividing lines or boundaries when it comes to God's all-encompassing love, but also to live and love and show up and speak out and advocate for just and equitable ways of living together? For we belong to God, but we also belong to each other. May we be as brave and persistent and fierce as this woman was when she spoke on behalf of her daughter. Kinship is what happens to us when we remember that we belong to each other. We are bound to each other by God's love. Whether we always feel it, whether we always know it, it is the truth. That is the truth of God's love for us, that we are bound to each other. That is what makes us brothers and sisters in this world. That is what makes us kin. Let us stand and affirm our faith in the words of the Nicene Creed. We believe in one God,
the Father, the Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things are made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven. By the power of the Holy Spirit, he became incarnate from the Virgin Mary and was made man. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again, in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son. The Father and the Son, he has worshipped and glorified. He has spoken from the prophets. We believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism.
The prayers of the people are Form 4. Let us pray for the church and for the world. Grant, Almighty God, that all who confess your name may be united in your truth, live together in your love, and reveal your glory in the world. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Guide the people of this land and of all the nations in the ways of justice and peace, that we may honor one another and serve the common good. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Give us all a reverence for the earth as your own creation, that we may use its resources rightly in the service of others and to your honor and glory. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Bless all whose lives are closely linked with ours, and grant that we may serve Christ in them and love one another as he loves us. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Comfort and heal all those who suffer in body, mind, or spirit. Give them courage and hope in their troubles, and bring them the joy of your salvation.
I ask your prayers for Patty Collier, who's suffering from lupus. I ask your prayers for the family of Bill Hansen and Hansen's brother-in-law, who died about 3 weeks ago. I ask your prayers for Mary Churchill and Stephen Siciliano, who are going through the discernment phase of ordination in this diocese. I ask your prayers for John Meichner, who is still recovering from shoulder surgery, and for the father of Michelle Kessel, George, who is in rehab in Delaware. I ask your prayers for Duane, who is still recovering from her surgery a couple of weeks ago.
Lord, in your mercy, we commend to your mercy all who have died, that your will for them may be fulfilled, and we pray that we may share with all your saints in your eternal kingdom. Lord, in your mercy,
O Lord, our God, accept the fervent prayers of your people. In the multitude of your mercies, look with compassion upon us, and all who turn to you for help. For you are gracious, O lover of souls, and to you we give glory, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, now and forever.
Amen.
Let us confess our sins against God and our neighbor. Most merciful God,
we confess our sins against you. In thought, word, and deed, thy will be done, and thy will be done. We have not loved you with all our heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry, and we humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we may be led in your will and walk in your ways. To the glory of your name.
Almighty God, have mercy on you, forgive you all of your sins through our Lord Jesus Christ, strengthen you in all goodness, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, keep you in eternal life.
Amen.
May the peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with you.
Thank you.
Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
And lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give thanks and praises.
It is right and it is a joyful thing, always and everywhere, to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth, for by water and the Holy Spirit you have made us a new people in Jesus Christ our Lord, to show forth your glory in all the world. Therefore we praise you, joining our voices with angels and archangels, and with all the company of heaven who forever sing this hymn to proclaim the glory of your name. Holy,
holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest.
Holy and gracious Father, in your infinite love you made us for yourself. And when we have fallen into sin and become subject to evil and death, you, in your mercy, sent Jesus Christ, your only and eternal Son, to share our human nature, to live and die as one of us, to reconcile us to you, God and Father of all. He stretched out his arms upon the cross and offered himself in obedience to your will, a perfect sacrifice to the whole world. On the night he was handed over to suffering and death, our Lord Jesus Christ took bread, and when he had given thanks to you, he broke it and gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat. This is my body which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." After supper, he took a cup of wine, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is the blood of my new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this for the remembrance of me." Therefore, we proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ is risen.
Christ is risen. Christ will come again.
We celebrate the memorial of our redemption, O Father, in the sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving, recalling his death, resurrection, and ascension. We offer you these gifts, sanctify them by your Holy Spirit, to be for your people the body and blood of your Son, the holy food and drink of new and unending life in him. Sanctify us also, that we may faithfully receive this holy sacrament and serve you in unity, constancy, and peace. And at the last day, bring us with all your saints to the joy of your eternal kingdom. All this we ask through your Son, Jesus Christ, by him, and with him, and in him, in the unity of the Holy Spirit. All honor and glory is yours, now and forever, Almighty Father. Amen. And now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to say, "Our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever.
Hallelujah. Christ our Passover is sacrificed for us.
Therefore, let us keep the peace. Hallelujah.
Let us say together the Agnus Dei. Lamb of God,
you take away the sins of the world. Have mercy on us.
Lamb of God,
you take away the sins of the world. Have mercy on us.
Gifts of God, the people of God, take them in remembrance that Christ died for you and feel them in your hearts by faith with thanksgiving. Feel free to stand or remain seated, whichever is more comfortable for you.
Thank you.
hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God and of the Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be among you and remain with you this day and forevermore.
Amen.
Please be seated. Just a couple of brief announcements. For the last 8 weeks, we've been doing a Zoom series that we've had anywhere between 10 and 13 or 14 participants, most of whom were from our parish, but some of whom were from other places. And so Mary Churchill began that series by picking this thing called The Chosen, which is a wonderful YouTube series. If you haven't watched it, download the app and watch it. It'll be worth your while. You can do it at your leisure. So we all enjoyed this group so much, we decided we wanted to do something else. And so we're going to be doing a new series starting not this coming Wednesday, but the following Wednesday. It'll be sort of the same format. It'll be on Zoom. And I'll send out an invite to everyone in the parish. So if you haven't been doing it before now and you wish to join us, you're welcome to join us. And we're not an exclusive club, so you're all entitled to come there. We're not calling you Gentiles or that dog or anything else like Jesus did. We're going to say, come on and join us. And so, the thing we're going to be talking about is this book called Gilead. This was a novel that was written about 13, 14 years ago by Marilynne Robinson. She won the Pulitzer Prize in fiction for it the year that she wrote it. And it's a really, really cool story. There's no chapters, it's all one chapter. A really cool story of this guy in Ames, Iowa, who was a pastor of a congregational church there. And he has learned that he is going to be dying soon. And so it's a love letter to his son. And it's a beautiful rendition of his life. So we thought it'd be fun for you guys to participate in that. And Mary and Stephen, both of whom are going to be in the ordination process. Stephen already is. Mary's going to be joining him in that process jointly. So the two of them are going to kind of co-lead this series, and I think it'll be fun for all of them and fun for all of you if you can join us. So we'll be starting that a week from this coming Wednesday. I'll send out the link to the whole parish to my Zoom page. It will accommodate 100 people. I doubt that we'll get that many, but as many of you as want can come and join us. 6:30 on Wednesday evening, and it's about an hour-ish or so, okay? The other thing I wanted to announce is that Friday was a good day at the food pantry. I told you about some troubles that we've had at the food pantry lately, but we've turned a corner. We had a good number of participants, all of whom were from this parish, and served the people in the way that we customarily do, welcome them, and we intend to turn this corner and go further ahead. We're going to outfit the classrooms up here starting soon to use as the pantry serving place, because they've been in the undercroft and it's gotten kind of crowded down there, and this is going to facilitate the movement of all the people who work down there, as well as all the people who come to receive food on Friday afternoon. So if any of you are interested in becoming a part of that ministry, you can reach out to Karen or Linda. They are sort of co-chairs of this process that we have going forward. And so let me just ask you to give a huge hand to Linda and to Karen and to Sue Willis, who's participated in this very, very heavily, because they have worked their tails off in the last 3 months, keeping this thing going, taking it to a new place, and moving forward with this ministry. And I can't tell you how proud of you. Any other announcements? Okay, we're ready for our final hymn.
Yes, Karen.
Oh, wait, Karen. Yes. Linda. Thanks for reminding me.
Please stand up.
our closing hymn.